coming on Saturday morning to listen to what I believe is going to be a very interesting talk on Freemasonry and particular symbolism and sometimes the hidden meaning behind those symbols. Freemasonry is a peculiar system of morality, veiled in allegory and illustrated by symbols. And therefore, whilst we've moved on from that to describe Freemasonry as an organisation of good men supporting each other, their families and the community, for many of us, the symbolism contained in the craft is the clue that helps us to explain the lessons in the teachings. This morning, we have the privilege of one of the finest minds in Freemasons, Victoria, talking to us on symbolism and the evolution and changing of meaning of some of these symbols. Worship Brother Brendan Kine. Brother Brendan started his Masonic journey in the Gordon Lodge in 2004 and was master of that in 2011. Since 2006, he's been a member of the Victorian Lodge of Research and has delivered many papers on Freemasonry and has recently been asked to lead the new education group within our portfolio of volunteer action groups. Worship Brother Brendan.
Thank you, Keith. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for coming. Today we're going to have a quick look at Freemasonry and symbolism. I'm a bit of a latecomer to the whole topic of symbolism. I'm more from the research side of things. You know, give me a box of old musty papers and books and I'm as happy as, or even the website Trove, if you don't know that. It's a great site where they've digitized so many newspapers and stuff, so it's just a great resource. So that's more the angle I come from, and that's going to be a bit reflected in this morning's paper. But it was just a few years ago where Freemasons Victoria asked if I would participate in a new initiative they had where we actually explain the symbolism of the various ceremonies to our new guys when they join. And I said, yes, I'll do that. But I thought, before you can do that, you've really got to, in your own mind, understand those symbols and the symbolism and where it comes from before you can even start to try and explain it to someone else. So that's why I say I'm a latecomer to the whole area of symbolism. Now, this morning, I'm not going to stand here for 45 minutes and read a paper with lots of ponderous conclusions, because I know you'll all soon be looking at your phones going, when's he going to shut up? It's going to be more casual. I'd very much like your input. At any point you've got a question or an observation or something, just interrupt. I think we'll have a much more fulfilling morning if we take that approach rather than me standing here talking for 45 minutes. So for the first bit, we'll have a look at some symbols, some of them Masonic, some not, and how those symbols have possibly changed over time. And how also, I suppose, the meaning can change, but people can also attach their own meaning to a symbol that possibly wasn't there in the first place. And Freemasons at times are a little bit guilty of that. And in the second part, we'll actually have a look at Victorian Freemasons in the 1800s and the public displays they would have of their symbolism. They were quite often out in the public displaying some of their symbolism, and a lot of that actually comes from the entered apprentice ceremony in a Freemason's lodge. So naturally enough, we're going to finish on the entered apprentice ceremony in a Freemason's lodge, and I will explain to you some of that symbolism. So for the non-Masons in the room, I'm going to be figuratively taking you into parts of that ceremony when a new guy joins Freemasonry. Now, hopefully you'll get a glimpse of some of the beauty of the ritual and ceremony in Freemasonry. And as our subject matter this morning is symbolism, naturally there's the dreaded PowerPoint presentation. Now, I was told a few years ago a PowerPoint presentation should not be more than 12 slides, otherwise you're going to lose your audience. Well, this morning we've got a hell of a lot more than 12 slides, because basically I want the symbols to do a lot of the talking for me. I want them to have their impact. So that's the reason for the approach. And when Samantha rang me and said, how would you like to do this, My first thought, who's seen the movie The Da Vinci Code? You know, one of the opening scenes in that movie is the main character, Professor Robert Langdon, doing a presentation on symbolism. And I thought, that's a really good place to start. How many of you know, actually, that that character, excuse me one moment, is actually based on a real Freemason? You all knew that, didn't you? No, it is. Brother Robert Lomas. Now, Brother Lomas is quite a prolific Masonic author over the years. However, his first few books I would class as alternative history. You know, I disagree with an awful lot of the approaches he takes. But later in life, he's mellowed a little. So today we'll actually be touching on his book on Masonic symbolism. So we'll come back to that. But yes, the character in the Da Vinci Code is actually based on a real-life Freemason. So let's kind of kick off. Now, our first symbol I thought we'd consider, and I had to really think about whether I wanted to use this one or not. I've decided to go with it. The response it kind of elicits from us very much depends on, in a fashion, cultural background. So for most of us in this room and myself, I feel awfully awkward having that up on the screen. Because of we all associate Adolf Hitler, the Second World War, and the horrors of the Holocaust. So some of us feel quite uncomfortable having that up there, so we'll just move on one second. And see, instantly, we all go, ah. And just in that one little bit there, you can see how we've gone from the symbol where we all go, oh, okay, is that what this is going to be about this morning? And suddenly we have, ah, now I'm going to, no, not yet. And suddenly we have a symbol of, hang on, if I book that family holiday. I digress though. So, the first symbol there, we won't go back to it because I don't want to have it up there for too long. I'm going to refer to it by its English term in the 1800s, which is the philfot. It's not the swastika, it's the philfot. And as we know, that symbol can be found throughout Asia and it dates back thousands of years. Thank you. So there we have an example from Armenia, one from India, and one from Northern Europe, Greece, and Bosnia. So as you can see, this symbol has occurred throughout civilizations for many, many years. And it's considered a sacred or auspicious symbol in most of the religions that have developed out of the Indian subcontinent. Hinduism, Buddhism, Sikhism, Jainism, they all have that symbol as something as a lucky object. So it really was kind of perverted. And as I said, its literal meaning is a lucky or auspicious object. So, in a fashion, our reaction to that symbol is very much culturally based. So for most people in this room, we are repulsed by that symbol, but if I was addressing an audience of Hindu people in India, their reaction would be completely different. Now, to further illustrate this point of how that symbol has changed, in Western society, pre the Second World War, it had even crept into sporting clubs. So here we have a women's Canadian hockey team from the early 1900s and American men's basketball team also from the early 1900s. Now, can you imagine if a sporting team did that 30 years later? That would be rightly so construed as some sort of anti-Semitic political statement. But at that point, it was much more innocent times. That symbol had almost an innocent nature to it when we compare it to today.
Brendan?
Yes?
The difference between the two of them is they're reversed.
Yes. Yes. And as David pointed out to me earlier, with the Nazis, they actually deliberately reversed it and gave it that connotation. The philfot. Interestingly though, not long after I joined Freemasonry, being a researcher, I'm picking away at things, I came across this one. And I thought, what the hell is that doing in a branch of Freemasonry? Your initial reaction to it is to go, why is that there? But when you realise, though, this dates from the late 1800s and actually is formed in an operative Freemason's lodge by four principal officers putting their squares together. So that is actually made up of four builder's squares. So it takes on an almost innocent connotation to what we know it as today. So you can almost see, though, in that particular instance, how that could be taken out of context and used in some, you know, bizarre Freemasons, Hitler kind of conspiracy theory. But we know that that was not the case. It had a much more innocent definition to it. And while we're on the subject of squares and symbolism, which is what this morning's about, what I have here is half of the famous symbol of Freemasons, a square. And in Freemasonry, we tend to use operative tools of measurement because we believe that a man's greatness can be measured by his deeds, his actions, his upright character, his square conduct, so that if we live a life that's on the square, we will live respected and die regretted. And I think that's a wonderful bit of symbolism. And that's the kind of simple symbolism that we use in our lodge rooms to stress to the guys, this is what you can be. And I was chatting to our CEO the other day, and she's kind of worked out one of the main secrets of Freemasonry. And I thought this morning I'd let you all know what one of the secrets of Freemasonry is, because there's lots of non-Masons here, and it's really quite simple. To know yourself. Sounds easy, but it's not that easy. You know, today, when you think about it, how well do you know yourself? Or are you just a reflection of what other people know of you? And that's part of Freemasonry. It's part of the journey of Freemasonry, is to know yourself. So let's move on from that. And now I want to look at a symbol where another meaning can be construed from it. And in this particular instance, because I'm a Freemason, I view that picture differently. Now, as many of you know, that comes from some superannuation advertisements that were recently on television. And it had the tagline, from little things, big things grow. In other words, you know, over time your super will grow. But to us Freemasons, we saw a different image. Thank you. There's a Scottish Freemason doing his Jew Guard sign. Now, I can't actually tell you at what point in a ceremony he uses that sign, and I can't also tell you how he gets to that sign, but I can tell you the meaning of that sign. Because when a Scottish Freemason joins Freemasonry, and when we all join Freemasonry, we take an obligation that we will be honourable men. And in the Scottish context, they take that obligation and they place the volume of their sacred law on their left hand and they place their right hand upon it. And that's what that symbol is symbolising. So every time they make that sign, it reminds them of the day they joined Freemasonry and took that obligation to be an honourable man. So just an example of how a simple ad on television, because I'm a Freemason, I looked at that ad from a totally different perspective. Now, let's have a look at symbols supposedly hidden deliberately in plain sight. I think we're all quite well versed with the creation of Adam, Michelangelo's picture from the Sistine Chapel. A lot of researchers recently have suggested there is other symbolism hidden in this particular picture. I'm not sure I agree with it, but some suggest that the human brain is hidden in that picture. Now, Michelangelo was an extremely pious man. I have my doubts as to whether he would have done that, put the whole concept of God in the human brain, and you kind of get where, what road that leads you down. So I don't know, I'm in two minds as to whether that could be a possibility or not. I'm kind of leaning towards the no. But it gives you an idea how people can reinterpret something and put their own meaning into it. Now, one particular researcher has gone to an awful lot of trouble with that particular part of this picture, and he's accidentally stumbled upon the Masonic symbolism that is hidden in it. Phew, this guy has spent pages at a website putting all this stuff together, and can I just say, it's utter rubbish. He's figured out the fingers are in an M shape, and then I've just given you a sample here. He's gone throughout history and found pictures of famous people making that kind of sign. I've never seen that in Freemasonry anywhere. It's just bizarre. And the amount of effort that person has put into that. If only he'd used all that effort for good and not evil. Anyway, so that I use that one just to highlight how a symbol can indeed be in the eye of the beholder. And quite often people will put their own interpretations onto a symbol, and possibly, and as I said earlier, Freemasons have been slightly guilty at times of over-symbolising symbols and looking for interpretations that sometimes quite aren't there. Now, let's have a look at a distinctly Masonic symbol, shall we? There we go, the Lodge of Edinburgh. Now, the Lodge of Edinburgh, St Mary's Chapel No. 1, meets in Hill Street in Newtown in Edinburgh. In 1893, the Lodge bought the 19 Hill Street building and turned it into a Masonic Lodge. To stamp their mark on the building, the Lodge commissioned a symbolic diagram to go above the door to the Hill Street entrance. At a committee meeting in October 1893, held at the Lyric Club, and I quote, "The Right Worshipful Master Dr. Dixon submitted sketches of a design he had invented to be put in stone above the front of the hall, and this was approved of." And there it is. The design is somewhat oblique in presentation, and really it's ripe for Masonic conspiracies. If I may read you one extract from a website. "This one is for all the Da Vinci Code enthusiasts, aspiring Illuminati, and Knights Templar conspiracy theorists out there. These symbols above the door of Mary's Chapel make Sudoku look easy. I can make out the initials for Masonic Lodge, Edinburgh Chapter Number 1, but what on earth could be the significance of 1893? Don't try and tell me it's the building date." Well, I hate to disappoint you, it's the building date. Now, it looks a little enigmatic, doesn't it? Are there any thoughts on what that could be illustrating? Because I must admit, when I first saw it, I thought, what the hell is that? And basically, I'll have to tell you, it's definitely obscure. And you can see why people are starting to suspect that it's got other meanings, but it's quite a straightforward meaning. An encircled star with a series of numbers and symbols has been boldly carved into the stone, and I'm actually quoting from a book here called Secret Edinburgh, An Unusual Guide. "The four numbers around the outside of the circle are simply the date 1893. Around the star are the letters LEMC number 1, which is a simple abbreviation for Lodge of Edinburgh, Mary's Chapel number 1. The other 16 Pictish rune symbols are the personal signature marks of each of the officials of the Lodge at the time, four of whom were Grand Lodge bearers. And the Right Worshipful Dr. Dixon appears himself at the top as the letter H, right there, with a rising sun." So it's really quite innocent, but you can imagine people looking at that and going, "Oh, stars." And I love it. There's even marks in the stone here, and I'm sure if you got a ruler and a pencil, you could get all sorts of diagrams out of that and make all sorts of conspiracy theories, when really it's nothing of the sort. So those two instances there are cases where people are probably over-symbolizing a symbol. So let's have a look at one that possibly does have hidden meaning, shall we? Hieronymus Bosch, the Wayfarer. Now, the symbols in this painting may possibly be alluding to very early Freemasonry, or is it a case of over-interpreting the symbols? Now, Bosch was born in the Netherlands in 1450, died in 1516, and painted the Wayfarer in 1510. Masonic author J.J. Robinson, in his book A Pilgrim's Path, argues that this particular painting is full of references to early proto-Freemasonry. So is our late Brother Robinson correct? And has Bosch depicted the travelling journeyman Mason on his travels? Now, for those of you who don't know what a journeyman Mason is, hundreds of years ago when a young apprentice finished his apprenticeship as a Mason, and say in the French context, he would then go on the journey, his Tour de France, which still exists as a bike race too. He would go on his Tour de France as a fellow craft Mason. And on that tour, there was inns and that he would stay at, specific ones, because he wasn't allowed to stay in any debauched ones. And along the way, he'd pick up work so that when he finished the Tour de France, he was then a fully skilled Mason. So is Hieronymus Bosch depicting a journeyman Mason? Now, the central figure, the Wayfarer, is glancing back upon a scene of drunken debauchery whose inhabitants are perhaps considered no better than the pigs at the swill in the foreground. The Wayfarer is obviously either turning his back on such a lifestyle or has no time for such depravity and merely glances back whilst walking on. Now, as to the actual Wayfarer, Freemasons in the room will immediately notice that he has a bare knee, a slipshod foot. And although he's hooded, he has a superfluous hat in his hand, which has a distinct circle on it, with a point in the middle and a plumb bob attached to the centre. We don't use the plumb bob in Victorian Freemasonry, but in New South Wales, if they wander around like that, they're doing the sign of the plumb bob. Directly above the Wayfarer is an owl, an ancient symbol of wisdom, while the gate in front of him has a distinct elongated builder's square, from the era at the time. So possibly Bosch is depicting the skilled and properly prepared journeyman Mason, displaying his high moral standards as he remains on the path of rectitude and fidelity. Our friend, our brother, our late brother, Brother Robinson, says, "It is possible, of course, that the Masonic symbols in this painting are merely coincidences. If so, this is the most incredible collection of Masonic coincidences that we've ever expected to see assembled in a single work." And perhaps he may have been on the right path. For as other people have suggested, that's what that painting symbolises. And for the Masons in the room, you'd probably go, okay, I get that. So possibly he was depicting Masonic emblems. We'll just never know. Never know. So to recap, the symbol, so far from what we've looked at, they can be a powerful and effective means of communicating an idea or a concept or a particular course of action, clearly and quite succinctly. Whilst on the other hand, a symbol can have different meanings to different people. Equally as much, the meaning of a symbol can change and evolve over time, or it can be lost, as happened with some of the other fraternal orders in this state. They actually lost the meaning of their symbolism. So we've briefly touched on different interpretations attributed to some symbols. So let's have a look at an evolution of one of the most known symbols of Freemasonry, our old square and compass. Now, just coming back to our dear friend Brother Lomas, who I mentioned at the start is the character that the Da Vinci Code guy is based on. He suggests in this book that there's a couple of basic designs that have keep reoccurring throughout history, and that these symbols are almost encoded in our DNA. And if we can have the next slide, please, Samantha. And here we have Newgrange in Neolithic Ireland, down the bottom there. So that one's about 5,000 years old. This one here is supposedly ancient Sumerian. Ancient Sumerian, but I don't know, that doesn't look very ancient. I think the Iraqis have touched that one up. Anyway, the point is, it's one of the symbols that keeps reoccurring throughout history. So, excuse me. And he suggests that our compass and set square design is a refined version of that crisscross pattern, and that it is almost in our DNA. Now, let's have a look at the first time the compass and set square that we've ever been able to find appeared in print. Thank you, Samantha. Now, it was in a reprint of the Roman-era scholar Ptolemy's Geographica. And in one of the marginal diagrams... Oh, sorry, wrong one. Just stay there for the moment. Yes, I was going to say the compass and set square, one of our most known symbols. If we just go to the next one... I've kind of done a composite here, but right down in the bottom corner over there on your right is the first time the compass and set square with the letter G ever appeared in print. It's the first time we've ever been able to find that, and that's in the early 1500s. Now, the fact that this appears in a printed text in the early 1500s, the earliest that we know of, the inclusion of this particular square and compass motif was the work of the Strasbourg printer of the text, Hans Reinhardt. Now, he had used these symbols before in previous publications, but this is the first time he's ever put them in this configuration. And you probably can't see too clearly, but it's not the full symbol that we know today. It doesn't have that part of the leg. It's more of a gallows square. One end is longer than the other. So that's the first time it appears in print. And it seems as though it was very much by chance. The guys just put the symbols together. And in this particular instance, the G stands for geography. Now, over time, the G in the Masonic Lodge became geometry. It then became God, and as we all know today, it's Google. So how did that emblem, first published in the early 1600s in a German reprint of a Roman-era book on geography, become the most known symbol of Freemasonry? Is Brother Lomas right that it's an evolutionary thing, that it's almost encoded in our DNA? If we look at the next slide, this is the earliest I could find the use of it in a Masonic context. And there it is there, and you can see it's still not as refined as we know it today. It's still in kind of an evolving form. So you kind of wonder, is he correct? Is it encoded in our DNA, this crisscross pattern, and that's how it kind of happened? Now, I was recently at the Box Hill Masonic Centre. It's a relatively new centre. For those who haven't been there, it's an office building which has offices downstairs and lodge rooms on the third and fourth floor. I recently had to give a talk there, and it's the first time I've been to the lodge room on the fourth floor, and I wander in, and what pattern have they used on the door and on the wall in the east behind the principal offices, but a crisscross pattern that hides compasses and set squares in it? Now, was that accidental? Has the person who designed that lodge room read Lomas's book? Was Bruce Cowie involved? I don't know. Or does it support Brother Lomas's argument that it's almost encoded in our DNA? I don't know. I'll leave you with that thought. I don't have a picture of the, well, I do on my phone, but it's not on the PowerPoint because I only got sent it last night. Someone took a picture of the room for me and sent it to me. But yes, take my word for it, our brand new lodge room that we've built actually has a crisscross pattern in it. So now that we've kind of had a rough idea of where the compass and set square has come from, we all should now be able to pick, you know, Freemasons, their compass and set square. So let's have a look at our next slide. Now, obviously, that's Freemasons, isn't it? Ben, you can't answer. Freemasons? Yes? No?
No?
No? No?
Yeah.
Well, I tell you what, who said no the first time? Because you get a free gift. There you go. Correct answer. It's the Free Gardeners. They're not Freemasons. Free Gardeners started in Scotland in the early 1600s, kind of around the same time Freemasonry is kicking off as well. So here's this other organisation that uses aprons, collars, compasses and set squares, except they're Free Gardeners. Their whole thing was about gardening. All their analogy and symbolism is about gardening. So Freemasonry has come from operative stonemasons. This lot have come from operative gardeners. No, they were Free Gardeners, completely different. And they also developed 3 degrees, ceremonies the same as Freemasonry. It's just amazing that... Yeah. Yes, here in Victoria they nearly became completely extinct. But thanks to a couple of people sitting in this room, they've been given new life and they still exist. There's not a lot of them. And I don't know if many of you remember up the top of Elizabeth Street years ago, they used to have a building that had the compass and set square on it and the Free Gardeners. Or anyone here who's ever attended RMIT for any length of time would know that one of the buildings in RMIT is Forester's Hall. And that's one of the friendly societies like the Free Gardeners. And directly across the road was the Druids Hall, with the Druids coffee shop downstairs. And we're going to come to them in just a moment. So yeah, it's first slot, most people, and you'll notice this is the same group of guys. They obviously took an annual picture of their lodge. And they all stood in the same spot too. You stand there, you stand there. But most people, when they see that, would say, oh, Freemasons. But no, they're not. So if we look at the next slide, are they Freemasons? They've got aprons. They'd have to be Freemasons, wouldn't they? Anyone want to take a guess? Yes? Thank you, Keith. Dead right. They're not Freemasons. It's the Independent Order of Oddfellows. There you go. You can have a free one as well. Again, for most people, you know, there's a bit of indecision. Is that Freemasons or not? No. It's Mutual Manchester United Independent Order of Oddfellows. All right, let's try the next one. This one's much easier for you. Now we've got compass and set squares again. These guys are Freemasons, aren't they? You're dead right again. Who said that first no? You're dead right. That's the Foresters. The Foresters Friendly Society. There you go. Again, though, if you're... For the average punter out there, that's a group of Freemasons. But it was the Foresters Friendly Society. And if you're not sure what a friendly society was, they basically started up to offer working men health and sickness benefits and death benefits. So if you or any of your family died, they would pay for your funeral and burial. And you contributed money every week to this. And they all had a fraternal side to them, like Freemasonry. And over time, they all developed similar ceremonies to Freemasonry and similar symbolism. So to the average punter, that looks like a group of Freemasons, but it's not. Now, we'll just have a look at this one. I couldn't resist throwing this one in. All right, they're not Freemasons. They're Yarrowa Druids. You don't see people sort of parading around the streets like that anymore, do you? Who actually remembers a 1980s, 1990s band called the Talking Heads? Vaguely familiar? I'll just quote from a member of that band. I came across this quote just recently. David Byrne from that band. Turns out he's a collector of Masonic and fraternal jewels and symbols. And he says they really resonate with him, but quite often he doesn't know what the proper meaning of them is supposed to be. But I'll just read you this quote. I'm envious. What do I have now? I have a network of friends and associates, but a weekly hang with the butcher, the baker, and the guys from the IT startup doesn't happen. Can you imagine me suggesting to my local bank manager that he and I put on some freakish outfits, that he should hold the fake sword and I'll hold the staff with a snake on it? Now, maybe we're missing something with this stuff going out of our culture. And I think maybe we are. Maybe we are. So, the point is that our compass and set square, even though everyone goes Freemasons, but not necessarily is. Many other organisations have used it. Now, here's a quite specific example where someone has confused Freemasonry with someone else. The Brunswick Mess Hall. Now, the current owners of this particular establishment claim that our heritage-listed Masonic hall resembles an upside-down arc. ARC, that is an arch. Now, at the time I first came across this, I was actually looking for the lodge building that was built in Sydney Road in the 1870s. I actually think I've found it. It's the building next door. It's not that one. Freemasons never built one-story lodge buildings. They're always two stories high with the lodge building upstairs. And if you look really closely at this one, it says up there, MU Hall, which means it's a Manchester Unity Hall, not a Freemasons Hall. But the people who own this place may have been confused with an old painting or picture that was hanging around, such as this gentleman, who looks like a Freemason. But unfortunately, he's Manchester Unity Independent Order of Oddfellows. If anyone's ever been to the Shade residence, you'll know where that's come from. So we can see here, again, if someone looked at that, they'd go, oh, grandfather was a Freemason. No, he wasn't. He was an independent order of the Oddfellows. All right, here's a final one for you on safe ground now. Mason's jewels? Yes, no. Because we've got the compass and set square. We've got the senior warden's jewel there. Has to be Mason's, doesn't it? No one's going to commit to that one? Yeah, actually, it's not. It's not. Looks like it, but it's not. That's actually the jewels of the Independent Order of Oddfellows. They also used the square and compass, and in this case we have the jewels of the Independent Order of Oddfellows South London Unity Lodge. And again, for the average person looking at that, you'd go, oh, Dad was a Freemason. Well, no, in this particular instance, he wasn't. He was an Independent Order of Oddfellows. Oddfellows, you're kind of wondering where the hell that name comes from. I've often wondered. One answer I came across recently was that you had Masons and all these other people with names, carpenters, plasterers, all the rest. The Oddfellows was the group on the building sites that didn't kind of fit into any of those. So they had their own group called the Independent Order of Oddfellows. I don't know, sounds reasonable. So the point is, the compass and set square has now been associated with Freemasonry and other organisations now for over 250 years. Now, the United Grand Lodge of England, our oldest Grand Lodge in the world, is celebrating its 300th birthday this year, and they changed their symbol to this. What do you reckon? Better? Worse? Which do you prefer? That one or that one? Yeah, I think so. And I was so pleased recently, because I'm all for freshening up Victorian Freemasonry, but I was so pleased recently when we changed our branding that we kept it right there. And I'm quite happy that we did that. So that was the first bit I wanted to cover. Shall I plough on?
Yes. Is the heart, is the new symbol present there?
Yeah, that's for the United Grand Lodge of England. The one up, the heart is for their charitable fund. So the top one is for their normal Freemasonry, and the one with the heart is for their charitable fund. And I don't know. I'm kind of glad that most people in the room went, no, let's keep the old one. Yes. Now, let's not race ahead too far. Now, let's have a look at public displays of Masonic symbolism during the 1800s. Now, here in Victoria, particularly in the 1800s, Masons were very prominent out and about with public displays of their symbolism. Now, author Jessica Harlan Jacobs, and can I just add, it's great to see women are actually now doing fabulous books of research on Freemasonry. This lady is not a Freemason, but she has done an absolutely outstanding job of a book on Freemasonry. And she suggests in this book that Freemasons became part of the culture underpinning the British Empire, that Masons were accorded prominent places at official events whilst marching in processions in their full regalia, and everywhere laid the foundation stones to churches, halls, buildings and all manner of civic buildings. Freemasons clad in their regalia, and I quote, anointed the architecture of the empire with the symbols of their order. If you're ever in Ballarat these days, wander down the main streets and have a look at the foundation stones and look how many Masonic symbols are on those foundation stones. Now, a tradition developed in the 1700s of a formal ceremony conducted by Freemasons to lay foundation stones for the infrastructure of the British Empire. Freemasons became prominent and out in the open with public processions clad in their regalia as they anointed the architecture of the empire with their symbols. Now, we find Masons here in Melbourne and in the Port Phillip district during this period were no exceptions. The Freemasons were soon performing those public empire duties right here. And here we have a picture from 1846. Before I get to that one, in 1842 was the first time we did this. The Lodge Australia Felix, which had only been formed the previous year, led a parade through the streets of Melbourne to lay the foundation stone for the new courthouse on the corner of Russell and La Trobe Street. The courthouse that's currently on that corner is not the original one. And in March 1846, the foundation stone of the Princes Street Bridge was laid with full Masonic honours. And you can see a couple of people there in their Masons regalia. And that's one hell of a winch. Look at the size of that winch. So here you have laying the foundation stones for the first bridge across the Yarra. And who do we get to do that? The Freemasons. We're laying the foundation stone of the first courthouse in the colony. Who do we get to do that? The Freemasons. It's really quite strange that they had this ceremony that everyone would get them to come out and do. And as we'll see when we have a look at the entered apprentice degree, this comes very much out of that entered apprentice degree. That's a good question. Why don't we do it now? I suspect we don't do it now because most people who are constructing a building would go, you want us to do what? Freemasons to lay a foundation stone. It just wouldn't make sense to them. We've kind of lost that connection that people once had. It would seem like an alien concept. And not a lot of buildings these days have foundation stones. I mean, when we build one, we stick in a foundation stone. But do you think of most apartment blocks or any of those these days? There's no foundation stone. They just build the thing. So we kind of don't go in for that ceremony as much. But I would love to see it. And we'll get to one in a moment. But I would love to see a parade of Masons down the street laying a foundation stone. I don't know how keen Keith would be to lead that parade. But anyway... Yes?
With British colonisation of Australia, Freemasons, or did the British use Freemasons in other areas that they occupied?
Yes. Initially in...
This is not unique to Australia.
Not unique to Australia. So in America, India, every part of the British colony, South Africa, I think that picture there is actually in South Africa of them going out to lay a foundation stone. Here in Victoria, in New South Wales, Freemasons weren't exactly all that popular at first. All the first governors banned Freemasons and Freemasons meeting. Because being a penal colony, last thing you want is a group of guys meeting in secret. That all changed when Lachlan Macquarie turned up, because he was a Freemason. He saw the value in his officers, etc., forming a lodge, because in that era, if you were a gentleman or a businessman travelling around the British Empire, they all became Freemasons before they went off. Because they know that wherever they went in the empire, wherever they landed, there'd be a Masonic lodge, they would be welcomed into it, and all the crucial people they needed to know in that colony would be members of that Masonic lodge. So it served a completely different purpose back then. It was really a networking concept as well. And they became... You're right, they became very much part of that colonisation process. And hence the symbolism of this kind of stuff.
And the acceptance of it being in public.
Yes, yes. And as we'll see, because I'll just give you a few examples in a moment, the sheer coverage of all the local newspapers of any event like this, just the sheer detail of the coverage of it. And here in Melbourne, both government and private organisations would enlist Freemasons to lay the foundation stones of their buildings. Some examples in Melbourne where the Freemasons laid those foundation stones were the Supreme Court, Princes Street Bridge, Melbourne Hospital, the Temperance Hall, the Benevolence Asylum, the Gasworks, the Western Market, the Collingwood Bridge, the Australia Church, just to name but a few, and numerous of their own buildings. So everyone, the Temperance Society, for heaven's sake, build a hall, and they get the Freemasons out to lay the foundation stone. And the point is, all of these events were extensively detailed in all the newspapers, not just one, all of them. Now, here's an example where we get an impression of all this, when Freemasons within the colony laid the foundation stone for the new Brunswick Freemasons Hall in Sydney Road in 1876, and that was the one I was looking for earlier. And I'll quote this little bit from the newspaper. The town wore quite a gala appearance, bunting displayed on all the principal streets, and the afternoon being observed as a holiday by many. The stone having been duly laid and the members of the lodge returned to the lodge room in a full procession and the party sat down to a banquet which was the termination of the day's proceedings in a most agreeable manner. Now, apart from the obvious symbolism present here of the Freemasons marching in their regalia to their new site, laying the foundation stone and using all the tools and stuff to, you know, make sure the thing's all square, etc. Sorry, I just gone off mic. Technical difficulties. How's that? Beautiful. Sorry for that slight interruption there. And so they would prove the foundation stones with the symbols of their order. So there was this whole pageantry that went with it. The foundation stone would be lowered, they'd prove it with squares, etc., and make sure it was level. And you kind of get the extent of the surrounding community being involved, where the streets were gaily adorned with bunting. Much of the afternoon being observed as a holiday. So businesses closed down for the afternoon to go and watch the Freemasons lay a foundation stone. Gee, pretty impressive stuff. Another example, and this is one from my own lodge building, is the Ascot Vale Masonic Hall. from 1886. Pardon? There's the foundation stone laid by the Masons in 1886, again, extensively covered by all the newspapers. And the Freemasons, in procession, marched to the site of their new Masonic Hall, which again, gaily decorated with bunting. On arrival, an ode was sung by the scholars from the Ascot Vale School under the direction of the headmaster. So the whole school is out as well, you know, singing. And in the presence of a large assembly of Masons and local dignitaries, the foundation stone was laid with full Masonic honours. Corn, wine and oil were used to anoint the stone. It was proved with the symbols of the order, after which more odes were sung and then a return procession back to the council chambers to close the lodge. And again, we get a sense of the station Freemasons held in the community from the size of the event, from the fact the Ascot Vale State School kids got the day off, and that many of the local businesses again observed a holiday for the occasion. So they were huge events. But however, a much larger event occurred in the previous year when 1,500 Freemasons paraded through the streets of Melbourne to lay the foundation stone to their new lodge building in Flinders Lane. And we'll have a look at the 1,000. It's quite a lot of them there. That's them laying the foundation stone to their new building in Flinders Lane in 1885. And I'll just quote from the newspaper here. The laying of the foundation stone of the Masonic Hall in Flinders Lane East at the rear of their club premises in Collins Street was performed with a great ceremony this morning. The proceedings commenced with the assembling of grand lodges of the English, Scottish and Irish constitutions in the town hall, all three joining together in the main hall under the presidency of Sir William Clark, and subsequently they proceeded in procession to the number of 1,500 up the street to the site of the new building. A magnificent band headed the procession, and all brethren were in full regalia, bearing elaborate banners of their lodges and insignia, and the stone was laid with every attention to Masonic detail. Can you imagine the sight of that today? You know, 1,500 Freemasons parading through central Melbourne to lay the foundation stone of a building. Just not going to happen, is it? Now, the presence of Sir William Clark and 150,000 Freemasons in their regalia parading through the streets of Melbourne in 1885 affords us another glimpse of the position Freemasons held in the society and the image and the symbolism that they wanted to project as pillars of society. Clark even requested that the Premier consent, and I quote, to allow such members of the Masonic craft employed in the public services be spared from their duties a few hours' leave of absence in that they may in order to attend the demonstration. So you go and write to the Premier and say, give all the Masons the afternoon off. And if we just have a look at the next picture here, there's the front of the building that they're all sitting round at the back. And this is the only picture I can find of that old lodge building that's now been torn down. And this is in the 1960s. That sign there that says Freemasons Hall, 1885, that's the bottom of it just up there. It's a very dark photo, unfortunately. And that was just before it got knocked down and the modern hotel now sits in that spot. But the laying of foundation stones did give Masons a public prominence throughout the colony of Victoria. They were accorded prominent places at official events, whilst the processions of Masons in full regalia, coupled with the Masonic ceremonies of laying those foundation stones, provided a very public spectacle. At the same token, it again reinforced the idea of the unique place Freemasons held in colonial Victoria in the 1800s as a pillar of English society that could number amongst their number men of power and influence in the colony. Symbolism of the public possession of Freemasons and the laying of foundation stones gave a glimpse of an organisation steeped in ancient symbols, ritual and ceremony. And as we'll see now, and we might take a break here, we'll just stop there, the concept of laying the foundation stone originates from the Freemasons' entered apprentice degree ceremony. So do you want to take a break or do you want me to keep going for another 10 minutes? Okay, I'll just keep going for another 10 minutes and we'll all be done. So let's have a look at the entered apprentice ceremony. The first ceremony when someone who joins Freemasonry, this is, now I'm not going to go through the whole bit, I'm just going to give you what I consider some of the highlights of it. Now, when someone enters a lodge room for the first time as an entered apprentice, they're dressed in a peculiar way. I won't go into all the various bits of it, I'll just deal with one aspect, and that is they're blindfolded. They enter the lodge room blindfolded, we say in a state of darkness. And what we mean by that is, in some respects, that person is ignorant of their full potential. They're ignorant of what they can become. And so we say they're figuratively in a state of darkness, but we also, and I like this quote, we also say to them, because the heart must be made to conceive before the eyes are permitted to discover. Very nice symbolism there. Now, one of the first tasks of the blindfolded new mason as he comes into the lodge room is he has to go and tap three times on the warden's shoulders. Now, today, the two wardens in a lodge room sit with their chairs up against a wall of the lodge room. So they have to kind of do this convoluted leaning forward kind of posture so that the new guy can easily tap on their shoulder. Whereas 200, even 300 years ago, Freemasons' lodge meetings took place in an upstairs room of a tavern or an inn around a table. So when the blindfolded candidate was brought in, those wardens would have been sitting at chairs. Can we have a look at the next slide, please, Samantha? They would have been sitting at chairs at the ends of the table. You see the two guys down the end here? Here are your wardens. So it would have made a lot more sense to me that when a candidate is brought in blindfolded and these guys are sitting at a table with their backs to you, symbolically to get your attention, you were brought up and you tapped on their shoulders three times. Now you're probably wondering, why three times? Really quite easy. Ask and you shall receive the physical. Seek and you shall find the mental. Knock and the door will be open, the spiritual. Now you're thinking, hey, he's just making that up. No, I'm not actually. And I'll quote for you, from a Freemason's Pocket Companion, published in Dublin in 1735. Now this Pocket Companion was for when a gentleman might be, you know, waiting for a stagecoach or filling in some time somewhere. He could pull out his little Pocket Companion and it would have, you know, little anecdotes and stories and stuff for him to read. And I'll just read you this little bit. Now this is from 1735. That by living all good and godly works, by asking we may receive, by seeking we may find, and by knocking on the door of a heavenly temple, a temple not made of hands, it will be open to us and all true and faithful brothers. That to me is the significance of those three knocks on the shoulder. Now, let's have a look at where the symbolism of that foundation stone comes from. So we'll just go to the next slide. And what we've got there are, every lodge room has these, the rough and the smooth ashlar. And what this is a really simple visual explanation of what Freemasonry hopes to do for you. This, in theory, is you when you join Freemasonry, and this is you many years after lots of years of hard work, etc., You've taken off all those rough edges. You've revealed the inner man. You've started to find those inner characters and strengths that you have that you may not have realized that you had. And we apply, as I mentioned, I've done it again, sorry, and we apply tools of measurement to those stones. Symbolically, we apply the square, etc., in our endeavours to reach that perfect stone. Now, could I have a volunteer? Come on, Damien, just one second. Now, where the actual ceremony of that laying of a foundation stone comes from, just stand up here for a second, and just like that. We actually get the candidate to stand. Well, we did traditionally. We don't do that anymore, but we should. We should. We get the candidate to stand in the northeast corner of our checkered pavement. And once upon a time, he stood with his feet around that stone. There was the whole symbolism that he is laying his foundation stone and he's standing there with his feet around that stone. And we have a bit of ritual that we use at that point where we say to him, at the erection of all stately and superb edifices, it is customary to lay the first or foundation stone in the northeast corner of the intended structure. You, being newly initiated to Freemasonry, are placed in the northeast part of the lodge, figuratively to represent that stone. And on that foundation laid this evening, may you build a superstructure perfect in all its parts and honourable to you, the builder. Thanks, Damien. And that's kind of where that whole concept of Freemasons laying foundation stones has come from. Every person who joins Freemasonry is told that you are placed in the corner of the lodge to start building that new character. Now, are your foundation stones on a solid base or are they on shifting sands? And that's what that ceremony intimates to a new person joining Freemasonry. And to me, that's where that whole concept of Freemasons going out and laying the foundation stones of public buildings has come from. And I love that piece of ritual. It's beautiful. And also at that point, we stress that charity has to be the cement that cements those foundation stones together. Charity must be at the heart of every Freemason. But not just charity of the pocket, also charity of the heart and charity of the hand. And just to quickly kind of finish up, let's have a look at the first degree working tools. I have a set of them here. I'll pass them around so for non-Masons they know what they look like. And what we have here is the 24-inch gauge, the common gavel and the chisel. 24-inch gauge is to measure the work, common gavel to knock off all superfluous knobs and excrescences, and the chisel to further smooth and prepare the stone for the hands of the expert workman. But what we like to, as Freemasons, contemplate them as, and this is a really simple, they're simple tools of preparation, and these are really basic guides to lay on top of that foundation stone. So we say the 24-inch gauge, use your time wisely. Freemasons don't waste their time frittering it away. You've got a short time on this earth. Use it wisely. The gavel represents the force of consciousness. Control your passions and prejudices. And the chisel, we say, represents education. Educate your mind. Now, a chisel on its own is a fairly useless device. You might be able to stab someone with it, that's about it. A chisel needs an external force to be of any use. And in this particular analogy, that external force is you. Only you can educate your mind. So, really simple, but takes years to achieve. Use your time wisely, control your passions and prejudices, and educate your mind. It's something we constantly stress in Freemasonry, educate your mind. Now, just going back to the next slide, please. We have our two Ashlars. We have here the new guy when he joins, our rough Ashlar. We have here our Mason many years later. After much work, he has attained that. But then there's the third Ashlar. When I joined, it was always found in the storeroom or in a crumpled heap in the corner. That's also going to change. We have our third Ashlar, the perfect Ashlar. And to me, this symbolises the Mason after years of work, supported by the pillars of Freemasonry, brotherly love, relief and truth. And he's really kind of mastered the whole thing. He's now at peace with himself. And the more mystical Masons would say it's the perfected Mason suspended in space and time. I could go on. Would you like me to wind it up there? Okay, I'll wind it up there. Questions, please.
One of the things that you haven't mentioned...
Oh, there's a lot I haven't mentioned.
...is the trail. It used to figure quite prominently in our ceremonies. It's almost disappeared completely. Mm-hmm. And one part of the ritual says...
Monarchs have throughout all ages not found it incumbent upon themselves to exchange the sceptre for the gavel. But in every other jurisdiction in the world, it's trowel. For some reason here, we changed it from trowel to gavel. And there's a whole hashtag Twitter account, bring back the trowel here in Victoria. I don't know how successful it's being. And some say the inner guard, once upon a time, the guy who guards the inside of the lodge, that was his emblem. And that's what he admitted people into the lodge room on. I admit you on the point of the trowel. So, yes, that's something I'd love to bring back, along with the foundation stone and several other bits of the first degree ceremony that have been trashed over the years. Any other questions? Yes?
You showed us where the square accounts have come from ancient times through Rome and then through us and then to the Druids, not the Druids, the Elkfellows and all the others.
Foresters.
And the Free Gardeners. Now, I can understand being a Freemason why they would take that symbolism, but why would they not want a much more independent symbolism away from Freemasonry?
Well, it's an interesting point with the Free Gardeners because they've had that from their early days. So possibly they had it before us. So it's quite possible that the Free Gardeners had the compass and set square emblem before the Freemasons did. We were still evolving it and they may have already had it. And in answer to the second part of your question, I know that here in Melbourne, Freemasons would form the very first lodges and then they would go on to form all the other fraternal societies. It was the same guys. So you could kind of see if that's happened in other places in the world, how they've kind of made those fraternal societies in their own image. So they were Freemasons, they've gone and joined IOOF and they've kind of brought their Freemasonry with them and that's influenced their development. That's my take on it. Anyone else? No? Oh, yeah, sorry. It changes all around the world. It's not... Yeah. Yes. We tend to, on most of our stuff, not have it. In America, they all have the G. In England, they don't have the G. I think the Scots have the G. So it varies from country to country. there's no specific thing that says you've got to have a G in it. So hence, that one there doesn't have the G. And you know, as you know, these days that's Google. No, I'm just making that up. Anyone else? The three pillars here. I can do that quite easily. The three pillars in a lodge room. We have three principal officers in a lodge room: the master of the lodge, and his two assistant officers, which are the senior and the junior warden. And they have a whole heap of symbols that go with their office, and each one has a pillar. And there we have the Corinthian pillar. So the worshipful master has an Ionic pillar. We say that's a pillar of wisdom, the wisdom of Solomon. The senior warden has a Doric pillar. And we say that... The senior warden has a Doric pillar, and we say that's a pillar of strength. And the junior warden has the beautiful Corinthian pillar, and we say that's a symbol of beauty, beauty to adorn the inward man. Hope that answered your question. And if there's not any more, I'll wind it. I could go on for hours, but you're all probably thinking that's enough for now. Yeah, everyone's nodding, that's enough for now. So hopefully you've found some of that slightly interesting, possibly a little bit interesting, and you're not thinking, gee, I wish I had stayed in bed this morning. So thank you all for coming, and I hope that was...
I'd just like to say on behalf of everyone here, Brendan, that was absolutely fascinating. I think we've all got new appreciation of some of the symbols that we have come across, obviously, in our lodges, but also out in the buildings and in some of the most unusual areas that you've spoken about. I think with what we've gained this morning, again, is in some ways that Freemasonry is not a journey that's got an end to it. It's a learning education and it's an improvement process. So much of what you would have thought about this morning, I'm sure, has prompted you to think about, well, I'd like to research that a little bit further and understand a little bit more. And I'm sure that, Brendan, you'd be more than too happy to help in that journey.
I certainly would. And this morning, I turn up this morning and there's a gentleman who lives in my street who's just joined Freemasonry. So I'll be giving him lifts to lodge and that sort of thing.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, Ben.
Thank you. Thanks, Keith.